my Razer mouse, keyboard, headset, monitor, laptop. If only I had a desktop PC with a Razer motherboard in it.
Well, isn't this your lucky day, kid? With the ASRock B550 Taichi Razer Edition, you can get Razer Chrome or RGB to enable all those sweet RGB effects. Links in the description below to find out more.
AMD's Zen 3 launch has caused a buzz all over the internet, where it's unfortunately followed a similar trend like our fellow Nvidia graphics card counterparts being sold out on day one in the first few minutes. But with this launch, presented reviews with different numbers. My reviews included, people were like coming to my review and saying, why are you getting different FPS to Linus Tech Tips? And in today's video, I'm gonna help explain why. Because the first reason is games and settings within those games. So basically, when I test things, I'll test things maybe using the in-game benchmark, or I'll test a certain part of the map with certain settings. And depending on that part of the map, there may be heavier shadows, for example, and that might take a toll on one CPU more heavily than the other, depending on how that game was optimized for those CPUs. So basically, in a nutshell, unless that reviewer tested on the exact same hardware and setup on the exact same location, and then they got different results to me, then we could come back and say, okay, why is this differing? So now that we're done with point one, we're gonna grab that little ball, we're gonna scrunch it up, and we're gonna put it up in the top left or right-hand corner, depends on which way you're looking at it. And then we're gonna go on to point two, because this is another ball that's gonna get scrunched up, and they're all gonna tie together at the end, where with a new CPU launch, and especially with a new CPU launch, and new products for that matter, we're generally given either a beta driver in the case of graphics cards, or in this case, a beta BIOS. And this was given to me directly from AMD, and I only had one motherboard that I could test with this beta BIOS. And so basically what this means is that there could be some potential issues with the BIOS itself that might not be able to give me the full performance or the way AMD has intended this CPU to be experienced. Now, I did see something on my 5900X and 5950X, and that was that they were being power limited at 120 watts each. And so when I saw this, I was like, well, do I change this? Do I not change this? And my answer to that is no, I'm not gonna change it, because that's what potentially the person buying it and getting an X570 motherboard could experience. And so I've gotta base my review based on out of the box settings. And that's generally how I test things at Tech Gear City, is I grab the product, put it in, lock in XMP profiles, because that's pretty easy to do. And then from there, we give you guys the results. So depending on which motherboard was tested and depending if they got maybe a newer beta BIOS from the company directly, they could be getting different results based on that fact alone. Maybe they had a BIOS that was really pushing the CPUs. But there's our second ball, crunched up, BIOSes. And it's pretty scary, right? When you think about it, we're all giving you guys the results as beta testers, because it's not a retail sample and it's not a retail BIOS. So I would like to see that corrected in the future with CPU launches. Reason number three, the Intel side of things. Were the reviewers using the Spectre and Meltdown patches, or did they disable them? For me personally, when I test the Intel CPUs, I always disable Spectre and Meltdown updates. And the reason being is, depending on the game, some games you don't see a difference, but some games you can see performance uplifts of 5 or even 10%. That's the worst case scenario I've seen that these patches do to the CPU performance on Intel's side. On AMD's side, I've tested this in the past, the Spectre and Meltdown patches don't really affect performance at all, because I think the Ryzen CPUs are already Meltdown immune, and disabling and enabling the Spectre patch doesn't really do anything at all to performance on AMD. But on Intel's side, those patches do something to performance. So whether you leave them on or not is up to you. Personally, every CPU I've used from Intel around here, I disable those patches because I believe the performance nerf isn't worth it if you're using your PC for gaming at home. So do these other reviewers, do they disable those Spectre and Meltdown patches? I don't know. I'm not doing their reviews for them. So we got the third ball, bang, that's three reasons. Now we're going on to the fourth. And you're like, man, is this list ever gonna end? And it will end soon, but next reason is CPUs especially. Temperatures, ambient temperatures. I'm in a generally considered a hotter climate than a lot of other people in the world. I know some people, say for instance over in Canada, might be in some really cold or cool climates. Some people in some parts of the US could be in cooler climates where I am. And now this is important for Zen 3 processors because when you're testing them, their performance is actually tied to the temperatures that they're experiencing, especially with precision boost. So the colder the CPU is, the better it's going to perform. So that in itself can affect numbers as well. For me personally, I test in 26 degree ambient temperatures at the moment because I'm not going to turn on my aircon. I don't believe in wasting power if I don't need to because I'm comfortable with these temperatures. And I generally test from around 23 degrees to 26 degrees C ambient temperatures. So depending on which reviewer you go to, they may have different temperatures, which ultimately, especially with the CPUs and Zen 3 and Precision Boost, can affect numbers too. Bowl number four, just screw that one in. Let's get on to bowl number five. Number five, what memory was used, especially again with Zen 3. If reviewer X has used 3600 megahertz CL14, reviewer Y has used CL16 3200 megahertz, or another reviewer has used 3000 megahertz, this can affect numbers depending on which review you're seeing. Now for me personally, when I'm testing numbers, I always use the same memory on all those CPUs in that same benchmark that you guys are seeing. I'm not going to be comparing a 10900K with 4000 megahertz memory versus the new Zen 3 with only 3600 megahertz memory. That's not going to happen around my channel. You're always going to get apples to apples. And in the case of the Zen 3 CPUs that I tested and I'm testing now, I'm using 3600 megahertz CL16 32 gigabyte kit, Corsair Dominator. And I say that in my reviews. And also if you're seeing other channels, maybe they could be using four sticks instead of two sticks. They could be using dual rank instead of single rank. All these things do make a difference in the grand scheme of things. And this leads us on now to bowl number six. And you're like, finally, Brian, finally, the final problem. And that's right. This got to do with the game update itself. So depending on when the reviewers test their, say for instance, there is a heap of different CPUs tested in a particular game. If those numbers were tested 2 or 3 months ago, and then that game has an update, that can actually change performance. And we're not talking about a driver update on the graphics card. That's different. Driver updates can increase performance, but also game updates can help with optimization, and that can improve things. For instance, when I was testing Fortnite on the Zen 3 processors, I had to go back and retest again, because when I started testing the 5900X and the 5950X straight away, I was getting stuttering with Epic Shadows on. And I called AMD about this and they said, okay, that doesn't seem right. Then the next day, there was a game update that came out and that fixed the stuttering. So that's how important the game updates can be sometimes in terms of getting you guys accurate numbers and FPS numbers. So I thought that was pretty funny that it happened within a span of a day. As soon as I got the CPU, I was testing this out and I noticed that. And I actually got proof with Shadow Play. I was capturing this when it was happening too, because I thought it was really odd, where I turned the shadows off or I turned them really low and then the stuttering went away, turned it back up again, there was some massive stuttering. So that can happen, but that's been resolved because the CPU was still in technically beta phase, and that's what happens in beta phase. Problems like that do come up and they do get fixed before you guys go out and buy them. So I didn't really mention that in my review because it's not worth mentioning, but it does make an important point about how game updates can affect the FPS as well. And now we grab all those balls or scrunched up pieces of paper or whatever you do. We chuck them in a basket, and that is Person X's review. And when we've got the next basket, that's gonna be the next person's review, and so on, and so on, and so on, and so on. And so hopefully that has answered the question of why results can differ from reviewer to reviewer. But one thing I'm gonna say is, if you guys can, I mean, most of you guys are awesome. Most of you guys really appreciate the hard work that reviewers put into this. But I will say one thing, it's a lot of work. It's a lot of testing. I don't have a normal life. YouTube is not a normal life. I'm working 100-hour weeks here. And when you get comments that, I don't know if people are trying to undermine your results or whatever, when you get these comments, They do make you scratch your head. I mean, if that was the only comments I was getting, I wouldn't be on YouTube. But because there's so many awesome comments and people appreciate the hard work you do, it does make you happy at the end of the day. But don't go to other people's comment sections, or don't try not to go onto people's YouTube sections and go, oh, these results are terrible, and no, this guy's got this result, and therefore his results must be the best because they help out my confirmation bias. That's something that doesn't help anyone in the tech community. Open communication, working through differences, and finding out what is the best recommendation for the person in which situation is what the tech community should be about. Anyway, with all that aside, if you guys enjoyed today's video, then be sure to hit that like button. If you have any questions or comments, then be sure to drop a comment in the comment section below. And with that aside, we do have the question of the day here, which comes from Michael Cypers, and they ask, could this work for the PowerColor RX 5700 Red Dragon? And they're referring to the BIOS flash that we did. We did a video on this, I'll put the link up here, where we turned a 5700 into a 5700 XT kind of. It's kind of halfway in between a 5700 and 5700 XT because it does get the clock speeds and the boosts, but it doesn't unlock the cores a lot of the time. So you will notice performance that sort of comes in between those two. And it's actually, I do recommend it if you can, but if it doesn't work, then you might have to backdate your BIOS. So do keep your original VBIOS if you're gonna do this, just in case something happens. And if you've stayed this far and you're enjoying that content and you wanna see it the moment it drops, sub button, ring the bell, and I'll catch you in another tech video very soon. Peace out for now. Bye.